Bismillah, walhamdulillah, my dear sisters and my brothers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. This is maybe one of the most important talks about the Islam that people have been following in the last 1400 years. And the content of this talk will hopefully educate you so that you know you are on the right path when you are following the Qur'an, when you're calling for the Qur'an and the Qur'an alone. And that's because the Islam that has been built on other than the Qur'an was a parallel and still is a parallel. What I mean by parallel? It looks like it is an Islam that Allah has sent, but in fact it is not. It has the appearance of, but is not. And I will explain a little bit further in this talk. On Tuesday, the 27th of April, 2021, this is just a couple of weeks ago, in Riyadh, the capital of Saudi Arabia, the Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman, in a national televised interview by one of the state television of Saudi Arabia, was interviewed by a well-known journalist. You can read the entire interview on the internet if you go there and say, Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman, the interview on April 27th, and you will get the whole copy. But what interests us here is what he said about Al-Islam and how Saudi Arabia is going to implement Al-Islam. In one, I've taken the English translations from a Saudi-approved website, meaning here it's been translated into English, and a version that the Saudis approve. So I've got nothing to say here in the translation. When asked about Islam, he said, the constitution of the kingdom is the Quran, and that the kingdom is not bound by any particular school of thought because the doors of ijtihad are still open. They are very open. Ijtihad means independent reasoning, because the sheikhs and the scholars tell us that this interpreting Islam has been closed and we only follow what has been said before. In other words, we can use our own thinking powers to reach a conclusion in Islam based on the text in front of us in the Quran. Elsewhere, Mohammed bin Salman said, and it's extremely important, and by the end of this little script here, you will understand why it is extremely important. He said, Mohammed bin Salman said, in social and personal affairs, we are only obliged to implement stipulations that are clearly stated in the Quran. Then he said, so I cannot enforce a Sharia punishment without a clear Quranic stipulation or an explicit stipulation from the Sunnah. When I talk about an explicit stipulation from the Sunnah, most hadith writers classify the hadith based on their own typology, meaning it's authentic or we can think like that. Then he said, like Bukhari, Muslim, and others. What they do is they classify it into the correct hadith or the weak hadith. Then he said, but there is another classification which is more important, namely whether a tradition or hadith has been narrated by many people or a single narrator. And this is a main reference for fiqh, for the jurisprudence, for deducing regulations, sharia-wise. With this statement, Muhammad, i.e., that we're not going to rely on the hadith just because it's authentic or it's good, that's it's going to become a law. No. Muhammad bin Salman is saying that from now on, we are going to rely on a hadith, depending on how many people narrated it. If it is mutawatir, the mutawatir, I've explained this, and you can find it on YouTube in one of my talks. For example, the Messenger of Allah would stand in a masjid and gives a talk whereby 1,000 people hear that talk. And then those 1,000 people, each one of them will tell it to another 1,000 people. And in a manner that the wordings used in his speech will not contradict any other of the other 1,000 people, which is impossible. It really is impossible. And as I said before, when Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, when he wanted to explain Sahih al-Bukhari, and as I said before, the real writer of al-Bukhari that we have today is Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, a man that existed about 400 years ago or less. We don't have the original copy of al-Bukhari. As a matter of fact, we do not have any original copy of any of the books that they say. Anything of Ahmad, Muslim, al-Bukhari, al-Tirmidhi, Abu Dawood, Ibn Majah, and we don't have the original text at all. But anyhow, so a hadith that is mutawatir is a hadith whereby the messenger says it to a number of people. And please go back to the YouTube channel when I speak about the mutawatir so that you understand this very important definition. The hadith ahad, on the other hand, is a hadith that was heard by a person or two or three and just talked to one person and two and three, and that's that. So Ibn Salman is saying all hadiths that are ahad, meaning where it's not a group of people and the number of the ahad is disputed between the sheikhs. But anyhow, that's another point. Again, go back to YouTube and listen to my talk about the mutawatir hadith. Ibn Salman is saying this. If the hadith is mutawatir, then you will look at it. And as long as it doesn't contradict the Quran, we'll be happy by applying it. Do you know what? With this law, with this rule, what Ibn Salman has done, he has taken over 99.99% of hadiths away from the Salafi Islam, which was imposed on the people in Saudi Arabia as a country, and because of the wealth, and you know, they think of themselves the big shots and the big sheikhs, the Islam that is around the world. Muhammad ibn Salman summarized his decision by saying, when we commit ourselves to following a certain school or scholar, this means we are deifying them, i.e. making them deities, gods. God Almighty did not put a barrier between himself and people. He revealed the Quran and the Prophet implemented it, and the space of interpretation is open permanently. As I said at the end of the talk, you'll understand why what Ibn Salman said, the Crown Prince said, is extremely important, and says that a new version of al-Islam is being designed, just like this, the one that people have been following, has been designed centuries ago. Furthermore, Muhammad ibn Salman adds, if Sheikh Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, the Wahhabi the man behind the Wahhabi doctrine in Saudi Arabia, and what he said here, he is straight away talking to the family of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab and the rest of those sheikhs that claim they are Salafis, but in fact they are just Wahhabis following what Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab said. And listen to what Muhammad ibn Salman, the Crown Prince, said. He said, if Sheikh Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab were with us today, and he found us committed blindly to his texts and closing our minds to interpretation and jurisprudence while deifying and sanctifying him, as the Saudis do, he would be the first to object to this. There are no fixed schools of thought, and there is no infallible person. We should engage in continuous interpretation of the Quranic texts, and the same goes for the Sunnah of the Prophet. And all fatwas should be based on the time, place and mindset in which they are issued. This is incredible. Wallahi, this is incredible. For years, a lot of people have been barking for this. And they have been called kafir. They have been, oh God, the accusations are huge. Yet a crown prince comes on television, says what he says, not a single sheikh of the Wahhabi or anywhere else in the world opened his mouth and accused Ibn Salman, the crown prince, of anything. Then he carried on saying, for example, 100 years ago, when a scholar would issue a certain fatwa, not knowing that the earth was round, and not knowing about continents or technology, etc., that fatwa would have been based on the then available inputs and information, and their understanding of the Quran and Sunnah. But these things change over time and are different right now. It's incredible. Ibn Salman, the crown prince, is saying nowadays the Islam that we are going to implement has nothing to do with the past. Before I carry on, my dear sisters and my brothers, I have kittens. My two female cats gave birth at the same time, believe it or not. One of them brought four and the other one brought three. So I have seven little kittens running around and hear all this meowing and things like that. Please ignore them, but anyhow, let's carry on with Crown Prince. So the message of the Crown Prince to the Saudi population and the sheikhs and scholars and all the religious institutions is that the Islam from now on for the future has nothing to do with the past. As a matter of fact, his message is clear, and he mentioned three things, and those three things are extremely important. Number one, the Ahad Hadith, i.e. singular narratives, where a person or two or three hears something and they say, oh, I heard Rasulullah. This Hadith, this type of Hadith, won't be accepted in the Islam, which is going to be followed in Saudi Arabia, and also as a result of that around the world, because as I said earlier on, the Saudis see themselves as the sheriffs. They are there to promote Islam. So once their Islam is no longer extremist, is no longer bloodshed, and is no longer the backward Islam that has been followed until now, guess what? The entire world will also change. What this also means is that 99.99% of the entire Islam will come to an end. We're going to start a new form and a new shape. Believe me, 20 years from now, you ain't going to recognize the Islam at all. Believe me, it's not. It's going to change. He also stipulated, the second point is that the doors of Ijtihad, and as I said, that's the independent study conclusion, things like that, are forever open. Why he says this? At the end, you will see that the sheikhs and scholars had held a meeting back in the 5th century, and they agreed that the doors of Ijtihad have been closed, and Muslims are only to copy-paste. So when he comes here, in this time, in this era, and he says, nope, the doors of Ijtihad are open, it means al-Islam, the entire Islam, as you know it, will come to a new set of interpretations. And this is absolutely fantastic. The third point that is extremely important, and he says, no religious punishment. This is known as the hudud. Every time they say the hudud, for example, if someone steals, cut his hands. If someone does that, cut the... So these are the punishment. He said, no religious punishment without a clear Quranic instruction. And for the Sunnah, things like that, he said, and was practically implemented by the Prophet. You know what's going to happen? The result is zero. No more punishment on earth, because all all what the Sheikh said, everything that they know, is based on hadiths alone and on the singular versions of the hadith. If, for example, if someone commits fornication, Allah in the Quran says, single or married, 100 lashes. The hadith says, no. It's 100 lashes for the single person who never got married. A man or a woman who was married, even if they divorce and even after 20 years they commit fornication, guess what? We stone them to death. This ruling will be flushed down the toilet because it's based on singular hadiths. And it's incredible. Reason, the scholars, that's what's amazing, is the scholar's position vis-a-vis what the prince, the crown prince, said, his declaration. Not a single man of religion dared oppose or contradict or even issue a fatwa or make a fast. Not a thing. They all kept quiet. Not even those highly ranked sheikhs, like the great Mufti of Saudi Arabia. He can say anything. And he is the grandchild of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, of the alliance between King Saud and Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. It's that King Saud, they do the politics, and Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, his progeny, the descendants, will do the religion. That's why always the grand Mufti is from the family of Al-Sheikh, from the family of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. Nothing. Even somebody who is considered, and this really made me one day really want to puke, when someone said Al-Fawzan, and he told me he is a companion living with us. I told him, no, he is shaitan living with us. This man has qualified kafir. Anyone who rejects one hadith, there you go, Muhammad ibn Salman has taken 99.99%. What is the sheikh? Not a single nothing. No one said Muhammad ibn Salman isn't a qualified person to talk about this. Muhammad ibn Salman doesn't have any Islamic education, and it's only scholars who can talk about this. He can't. Nobody issued a takfiri fatwa against him. But if you tell people, oh, I don't believe eating with the left hand is not a sin, they will tell you kafir because you're not following a sunnah of the messenger, a man-made sunnah. You see, these crooked men of religion didn't even dare to pretend defending al-Islam, which they say, oh, it's Sunni. After all, it's we have the Shia and we have the Sunni, i.e. the Islam that is followed is 100% on the Sunnah. So when Muhammad bin Salman came and said, oh, Bob, end of it, no more of that Sunnah, nothing. It has to be with the Quran, and anything has to be in the Quran and applied by the Prophet Muhammad. Guess what? 99.99% of what is said that the messenger practiced is ahad, singular. Abu Had bin Salman said, no more ahad. There you go. So, you see, the way things are today is a consequence of letting them roam free. It has cost us a lot. And it has cost people their lives, their livelihood. Many of the people in the 20th century and in this century, many were killed, people who were opposed to what the sheikhs were doing. Many were killed. Some were exiled, others separated from their wives. Other people that did not, for example, they say, oh, it doesn't matter with which hand you eat. When they died, they didn't want to bury them in the believer's graveyard and things like that. You see, the sheikhs have worked non-stop at turning Muslims as the most ignorant people on earth. You find someone who is a professor in the biggest science about the human body. He could be a gynecologist, he could be like the top heart doctor. And he still believes that when you drink the urine of a camel, that's a means of, it's a cure, it's a medication. And they accept it. Why? Because they say, well, Rasulullah said it. These people don't, our minds have been, la ilaha illallah, it's like we have the shape of a mind. But what the mind is supposed to be doing, the brains, it doesn't do it. I will give you a crazy something of the past that is totally crazy. And it will show you to what extent when the sheikhs were left free with Allah's religion, when they were not held accountable, to what degree they lied, they fabricated stories, and on top of that, they said anyone who does not believe in this nonsense is a kafir. And this and this topic is it comes from hadith, an authentic hadith. And this hadith is in Muslim, Sahih Muslim. Please understand that when a hadith is sahih, for our sheikhs, for our scholars, for everybody else, it equals an ayah from the Quran. That's why in the Salafi world, they believe that a hadith of the messenger can negate and obliterate an ayah. And that's why we are in the mess we are in. But anyhow, I'm going to tell you the story of a topic that is greatly believed in, and you will see what I mean by that. The hadith is called, it really is crazy, this hadith, okay? And it's found in books of the hadith, in the books of fiqh, in all kinds of things. This hadith is about breastfeeding an adult male, a complete foreigner adult male. Is breastfed by you, my sisters, or your wife, your sister, whatever. And the reason, for example, it's strange. It's one of those things that make you laugh, not because it's funny. It's because it's incredible strange how this thing found itself in the religion of Allah, a religion that Allah has made the easiest. You see, when if you are a teacher and you make the easiest exam ever for the students and you tell them if someone doesn't pass, there is nothing else I could do. Pretty much is the same thing that Allah has done. He's made the Quran so easy, so simple, that if someone really doesn't get into the Quran, they never get it again. And that's why the Quran is the end of the books, because if Allah made another book after the Quran, he won't make it as easy as the Quran. The Quran is the end of the ease frontier. All right, but anyhow, here is the context of the hadith, and all the hadith is reported in Muslim, in Muwatta Malik, in Abu Dawud. As a whole, the hadith is as authentic as I am talking to you. Aisha reports that there was a woman called Sahla bint Suhail. Sahla is a girl, a woman. Her father's name is Suhail. We don't care about the father, but that's how they call her. This lady is married to a man called Hudhaifa. The problem they have is this. They had a child whom they brought in, they adopted, they fostered, and the kid grew in that family. She did not breastfeed him, so she breastfed him, so he grew up normal. At one point, the young man became a young man, and the man, Hudhaifa, didn't like it much when this kid entered the house as he did. After all, to this young man, his name is Salem, that's his home, that's where he grew. He's not gonna let a kid grow in a place and then suddenly tell him, you know what, now you are a young man, go out. No, it's just, when he opened his eyes, he was a child, that's where he grew, and then when he became a young man, that was still his house. But the man Hudhaifa didn't like it. So Sahla, the wife of Hudhaifa, went to the Messenger of Allah asking for a solution to the problem, especially that Allah has revealed in the Quran that they cannot be treated as your children. If you know the parents, the father called that kid by the name of their parent. If you don't know this, then they are not your children. They have to understand this, because Allah doesn't want the relationship between humans get confused. So when Allah prohibited the giving the name and calling your child as if it's yours when it's not yours, there's no problem with fostering, adopting. I'm not saying that. It's just when the child grows with somebody thinking that is their mother, and when in fact it is not, or she is not. So the messenger, she went to the Messenger of Allah and said this, O Messenger of Allah, whenever Salem, again the kid, enters the house and I am there and he comes home, she goes, I see on the face of Hudhayfa, who is her husband, signs of disgust. And it's strange. Why would the man that you brought a child since the young age, why would you feel that? Like, what did you see that, but anyhow, the hadith doesn't go in that, but anyhow. Upon hearing that, the messenger of Allah said, of course, all this to me is a lie, but I'm telling you because it's in our books, the Islam that is followed today is based on that. So I'm just telling you what's out there. So they say that the messenger of Allah told her, suckle him. Suckle him is breastfeed him. She said, how can I suckle him? He is a grown-up man. The messenger of Allah smiled and said, I already know that he is an adult man. Now, in another narration, it's always the other narration, Amr, again, the other one, other narrator, added, Salim had participated in the battle of Badr, meaning he was really a young man, strong enough to go to war. That's what he meant. Already? And this really emphasizes that Salim was really, 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 without any shadow of doubt, an adult man. In another third narration by Abdullah ibn Umar, he mentioned, Abdullah ibn Umar, that the messenger of Allah had laughed when the woman was surprised by his answer. Wallahi al-Azim is strange. She has a problem. She's got a family problem. She goes to him, Ya Rasulullah, what can I do with this young man? Rasulullah tells her, breastfeed him. Give him your breast. Let him hold it with his mouth and let him feed on you. And then when she gets, he's an adult man. I know he's an adult. Just suckle him, no big deal. Ya Allah, la ilaha illallah. But anyhow, this is what exists in our books. Another hadith sheds more light on this one. Already? And this hadith is, I will tell you what the reason I'm telling you all this. There was a young man who would enter Aisha's house. A young man would come on our mother Aisha, enters there, goes out, no big deal. A young man, Aisha, for your information, at the death, when the messenger of Allah died, was 18 years of age. She was a young girl. She was not like 60 or 70 or 40. She was 18. So for a young man to enter Aisha's house, she was in her 18, 19, 20. She was still young. But anyhow, that young man would enter the house. Umm Salama, one of the wives of the Prophet, but this Umm Salama was old. She was in her 50s, 60s, things like that. She told Aisha, by Allah, I would not be content that this young man would see me. He has passed the period of fosterage, meaning he is no longer a small child that he enters the house and goes out as he pleases, and you are a young man, and he is a young boy, young man. Upon hearing this, Aisha said, why is it so? Why, Umm Salama, don't you do that? What's the problem? And then Aisha told Umm Salama why she's letting that happen. She told her, Sahla, the daughter of Suhail, this is the only hadith around the whole cake, came to Allah's messenger and said, O messenger of Allah, I swear by Allah that I see disgust and unhappiness on the face of Abu Hudhayfa. As I said, it's her husband. When he sees Salim inside the house, whereupon the messenger of Allah said, suckle him, i.e. breastfeed him. Sahla, the wife, said, he is, and this is, Allah, I don't know, what should I do? Should I just tear my neck down, or I don't know, or my, but anyhow, she said, messenger of Allah, he is a bearded man. He has a beard. He's got a big beard. The Prophet said, suckle him, and what you see on Hudhayfa's face would go. Sahla said, by Allah, I did not see any sign of disgust on the face of Hudhayfa. Meaning that Sahla had already went home, suckled the man. Oh, astaghfirullah al-haq. this young bearded man, she breastfed him, and I wonder, when she breastfed him, did she do it in front of Hudhayfa? Certainly not. Because if Hudhayfa is jealous just seeing this young man enter the room, do you think he's going to sit there and crossing the arms and he goes, oh, the messenger of Allah told you to suckle him? Go ahead, baby. Just give him your breast. Yeah, I'm just here. I'm just watching. I'm kind of like, yeah, just to make sure that all is good. No, he's going to kill her. But anyhow, so Sahla, in fact, suckled him and gave her a breastfed and fed him. And the jealousy of Mr. the husband went out of the window. Is this what Allah sent the religion with? Is that suddenly bearded man would go and breastfeed on women and the worst is still to come? A third hadith, again reported by Muslim. And this is, you see, Muslim reported it once, two, three, four, just like the hadith about the marriage of the messenger of Allah with Aisha, who is 6 years of age. You know how many times Bukhari mentioned in the Quran, it's the Quran to the Salafis, but in his book of Al-Bukhari, 9 times. Yahi, once is enough. Why 9 times? By now, this one is the third time Mr. Muslim reports it. The hadith goes something like, Sahla again, the daughter of Suhail, came to the Prophet and said, O Messenger of Allah, Salim, the freed servant of Hudhayfa, lives with us in our house and has attained what man attained, puberty. The Prophet said, suckle him, so you would become unlawful to him in marriage. Meaning this kid who was a child and now he is a... The husband set him free. Now the young kid is free, but he is an adult man. And you know the story. Again, the messenger tells him, suckle him, breastfeed him, and then you cannot marry him. A bearded man. The hadith 4 gives us more information about the whole story and also the reason as to why such a detailed narrative about this, I don't know how to call it. But anyhow, Sahla, again, the daughter of Suhail, came to see the Prophet and said, O Prophet of Allah, we used to look at Salim as a son. He dwelt with me and my husband in the same house, and he saw me in my short and personal clothes. But since Allah has revealed about them, the kids, as I said at the beginning, that you cannot consider them your children, she goes, and since Allah has revealed about them what you know, so what do you say about him? The Prophet said to her, suckle him, breastfeed him. And then the hadith in Abu Dawood goes, and it says, she suckled him 5 times. 5 times. And then he became like her son because of that breastfeeding. Because of this, Aisha used to order her nieces, the daughters of her sisters and brothers, and order them to breastfeed anyone that Aisha wanted for the other man to come inside her home. Aisha, an 18 years of age, would ask the nieces of Asma or Kulthum, these are the names of her sisters, that they should breastfeed adults, young men. Because once they breastfeed on the nieces, that's it. Aisha becomes like their blood, they become like a mahram, and suddenly they can come home into her room, they can spend the night. No big deal. There is no khulwa, there is no individuality. You're not isolated with that woman. Allah al-Azim, ya akhi la ilaha illallah. They're going to make me talk from my ears, these people. So they said that some man actually did breastfeed. Oh, la ilaha illallah. You know, my sisters, my brothers, why I am so shocked? Nieces of the sisters of Aisha, if Aisha was 18, the nieces should be what? 20. So they must be single, because for them to have adult men go to their homes and, you know, suckle 5 times until the kid, is, not the kid, the adult bearded man is satiated. They don't need any milk. It's not like, That's it. No, they have to keep cycling on the breast, on the nipple of the mother, in between the lips, taking the milk. I don't know. I don't understand much, okay? But I'm sure that the milk comes out only when babies are here. I don't know if the women are not like cows. You can't just pull the breast and milk comes out. Am I wrong? I don't know. But I'm sure it's not like, okay, come on here, 20 years or 18 years of your age, let me cycle on your nipples so that I can drink your milk and I become your brother. By now, the wives of the messenger, the other wives of the messenger, as per the hadith, did not accept this at all. But this hadith in Abu Dawood has been ruled sahih, i.e. authentic, by Al-Albani and any other sheikhs, which means that the Salafis consider breastfeeding adult man, bearded man, as an act of sunnah. My head's gonna crack here. And this is, they say, is part of Al-Islam. A small side note here about one of the brothers of Aisha, because Aisha had two brothers and two sisters. She has Asma and Kulthum, and she had Abdul Rahman and Muhammad. These are two brothers. As for Muhammad, her brother, he was killed in the most barbaric way on how you kill a human being. After the assassination of Uthman and Muawiyah took power, Muhammad was researched and he was wanted. So what they did is, he went to Egypt, and when he went to Egypt, Muawiyah sent his armies, his agents, to go to Egypt so that they catch him. When they caught him, what they did, in one of the narrations they say he was beheaded. And then, when he was beheaded, his head was decapitated, separated from his body, and sent to Damascus. When it got to Damascus, people took the head and showed it around town. In another narration, they say, no, he was not decapitated. He was just caught as he was caught. And what happened was, is just they killed him like that. They didn't. But it's the way they killed him that is even more hurtful. What they did was, they took him, in one of the narrations they said dead, in the other narration they say alive. But what they all agree about is that he was put inside the corpse of a dead donkey, and then both of them were set on fire. So if he was alive and was put inside the donkey, all this because of him being involved in the assassination of Uthman. Kill him, Yahi. Shoot him with an arrow. Kill him with a sword. But why would you put him inside a donkey? And why the donkey? But that shows how barbaric these people were. But anyhow, so as you can see, my dear sisters and my brothers, the idea about breastfeeding an adult man. Now, you might say, oh, this is an old thing. Come on, we are the 20th century, 21st century. Well, guess what? It happened that in Egypt, in year 2007, there was a doctor. His name is Izzat Atiyah. One day, on the 21st of May, 2007, people in Egypt woke up just like any other day, except that day would mark the beginning of something big, and big it was. People woke up on an article on a newspaper in which this Dr. Izzat Atiyah debated one more time the idea of breastfeeding an adult male. And the problem he did it was of a question asked by someone Salafi, someone of Egyptian, you know, Muslim. And there are women working with him. And at times, the man would find himself in khulwa, like the woman and himself are both in the same office. He goes, and as you know, being together with a woman in a room is haram. It's not haram. But anyhow, they say it's haram. How can I do, what can I do to, because I am in a dilemma here. I'm at work and I cannot just leave work, and women, well. So this doctor, Izzat Atiyah, gave him the solution. Really. He told him, this is on a national newspaper, the entire Egypt, over 100 million people would read it. It's incredible. But he went again to the idea that the woman can suckle you, and that way you become like her child, and that's it. You can be with her inside the room and no problem at all. You become a mahram. Being alone with non-mahram woman is not permitted, as they say, but hey, guess what, now you're gonna become mahram, so that's doable. Dr. Atiyah, this great man, told him that the woman can suckle you, and when she does that, it allows the woman to take off her hijab and show her hair in front of any she has suckled. But the Sheikh added, however, this suckling, this breastfeeding, will not prohibit marriage. Meaning that if she divorces and she's free to get married, you can marry her. So the man who suckles, who gets breastfed from her, can marry her later on. Now, to prevent manipulation and forgery, Dr. Atiyah called for something even more strange. He called for writing down the breastfeeding, go registered in the town hall and write it in a contract so that they know that so-and-so breastfed so-and-so. This fatwa, my sisters and my brothers, has caused a huge deal of unrest and confusion in Egypt. The main reason is this. Dr. Atiyah, Izzet Atiyah, was not a farmer, and he was not like a medical doctor or mechanical doctor. No, he was a religious doctor, a sheikh. Not only that, he was a teacher in one of the colleges of Al-Azhar University, and not any college. He was the head of the department of the Hadith studies in the University of Al-Azhar, meaning he was a big shot sheikh, huge big shot sheikh. Someone who would do this, it's incredible. You see, because of this breastfeeding permits khulwa, fatwa, and enables the woman to take off her veil and uncover her hair in front of whomever she breastfeed. But again, they can marry her. It's incredible. But anyway, this great scholar told an international well-known news station. It's called the Arabia Net. He told them, people have looked at the breastfeeding or suckling of an adult purely from a sexual angle and asked, how is it permissible for a young man or a man to be breastfed from a woman who is stranger to him? Then he added, these people have forgotten that it is Allah's messenger who authorized it. Strange, wallahi, strange. The Quran's gone out of the window. That's it. He then carries on. Whoever carries out an Islamic instruction is in fact following the Sharia law. And when an old man seeks to suckle, he is in fact just observing a legal license to apply the law, and because of that, is assigned the status of a young child. Me, Abdus Salam, if there is a sister, all right, and so I go to her and say, look, I really like you, and I really like you, you're a good person. I like you like my sister. Can I breastfeed on you 5 times? And after the 5 times, that's it. We become like my mother, and that's it. We can be together. You can take off your hijab, and we can be in the same room together. No problem. However, should your husband die, I can marry you. It just doesn't make sense. But the thing is, you tell her, okay, can I? And she goes, she's going to say, hey, but you're an old man. How can you do that? Don't you get shamed? What's wrong? No, I said, no. As I am practicing this license to suckle on you and other, I actually get the status of a young child. Meaning, I don't know how can a woman hide the beard of an old man as he is going at her breast, taking all the milk out of it, and only Allah knows. It's so incredibly impossible not to think of it from a sexual angle. But anyway, Dr. Atiyah has, this guy who gave the fatwa, he has refused any attack on the hadith itself. He said, if it is in Sahih Muslim, then it is the truth. And because of that, acting on it is nothing wrong. He further said, none of those who study the hadith or other sheikhs of hadith can ever doubt this authentic hadith. Some other sheikhs, when they saw in Egypt, and this was a big problem, my sisters and my brothers, so much so that the minister of the media in Egypt and the television and newspaper and everything ordered all newspapers on that day in the entire Egypt to withdraw that newspaper particular because of that fatwa. But it was too late, people had bought it, and it was, and it went to the people of the media, and that's it, and everybody knows of it. Once they knew that, what did the other sheikhs? They said, no, no, you people, you are an idiot. Actually, no. The messenger didn't mean to breastfeed him where the adult man would hold the woman's nipple in his mouth and suck the milk. No, 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 you got it all wrong, you idiots. Here's how it should be done. It's actually the woman would milk it in a cow. She would squeeze her breast until the milk comes out. She puts it in a cup, and then the cup is given to the man. But you know what's is the explanation is an insult, yeah? But them thinking we are idiots is even bigger, because the hadith says, ardi'ih, breastfeed him. And breastfeeding is not give him to drink, it's breastfeed him. You see what I mean? So my dear sisters and my brothers, the lies are great about this topic. By now, when one of the sheikhs was asked, and they said, oh, people are mocking this hadith and they are rejecting it and things like that, the sheikh said to him, the hadith about breastfeeding is authentic. Its application is a sunnah. I've never seen actually a sheikh, no matter what. If I go to any sheikh and I said, yeah, sheikh, I really want to spend some time with you at home. Can I come and suckle on your woman's, your wife's breasts and drink of, Allah, they will kill you. They will kill you because they will think, Allah, how come you dishonor? But no, it's Allah's religion has that. It's no big deal. By now, the sheikh, who is Nasr al-Umar? This one is again another sheikh, a Saudi sheikh from the Wahhabi school of thought. He said, as for those who mock and joke because of this topic about the adult breastfeeding, he goes, we really are afraid for them, for their religion. If these people are, Allah is going to make them hypocrites, he's going to make them kuffar and all that kind of stuff. He goes, because what they are doing are deeds only done by the hypocrites throughout time and place. It's always been the hypocrites who did this. And then he mentioned an ayah of the Quran. I wanted to pay attention to what Allah says in the Quran, how this shaitan in a human form, this Salafi sheikh, uses it, and look at the trick and the deceit he plays on people's stupid, feeble minds, the Salafis, because the Salafis, they don't think. He mentioned this ayah, which is in Surah At-Tawbah, that's Surah number 9, from the ayah 124 and 125. Allah says, وَإِذَا مَا أُنزِلَتْ سُورَةٌ فَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ يَقُولُ. And whenever a surah from the Quran is sent down, some of them, the hypocrites, ask, which of you has this, i.e. Quran, increased in faith? أيكم زادتوا إيمانا؟ هذه إيمانا؟ Then Allah says, فَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, as for those who have believed, فَزَادَتُمْ إِيمَانًا وَهُمْ يَسْتَبْشِرُونَ, it indeed has increased their faith, and they rejoice in that what Allah has increased in them. وَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ مَرَضٌ, but as for those in whose heart is a disease, okay, they are not disbelievers, they are believers, but they have some problems in trusting in Allah, as the majority of Muslims today are. Allah says, فَزَادَتْهُمْ رِجْسًا إِلَى رِجْسِهِمْ, it only has increased their evil on top of the evil they already have. وَمَاتُوا وَهُمْ كَافِرُونَ. And would, if they died like what they are right now, they would die as disbelievers. My sisters and my brothers, Allah is talking about Quran, not about a woman who takes a bearded man, breastfeed him, and the Sheikh wants me to accept this nonsense. Why? Because Allah talks about the Quran and he uses the Quran, the ayah that talks about the Quran for his own ending. And that's why, my dear sisters and my brothers, the plague and the falsification and the murdering of Al-Islam has been going on for long. I will stop here in the carrying on part two, and I will speak to you all, tell you the story of a king that altered the course of Al-Islam from its trajectory for until our times. For the last 10 centuries, Islam has been conducted, lived, preached, and everything based on what this king had decided. Now, off to part two. Salam alaikum.